Hello, Rabbi.
Good morning, good afternoon.
So in a previous conversation, we were talking about how Judaism is a guide to everyday living, you mentioned how Judaism has a different perspective on lying. You're saying it's okay to lie sometimes in Judaism?
Not only is it okay, there are times when you are required to lie. And this provides us with a wonderful moral compass. The overriding rule is you are forbidden to lie for self-aggrandizement, to make money, to fleece other people, for political reasons, to get into political office, to any time there's self-gain. The rabbi said our rules about required lying doesn't apply when the outcome of the lie is your personal gain. So let's move over to when you're required to lie.
I can't wait to hear this.
You're required to lie for shalom habayit. The word means peace at home. And we can expand home to mean a place where we work, a place where we worship. Now, what does shalom habayit mean? Well, you get into a heated discussion about something not of great consequence. Did you enjoy dinner tonight? Was it okay the way I prepared the fish? Let's say it was just mediocre. But for shalom habayit, you can say, I enjoyed dinner tonight. I liked our fish. Because it's peace between two partners, two individuals. And it gets us out of that classic joke, does this shirt make me look fat? And the joke is it's a double bind. What do you say? Judaism says there is no problem. For the sake of shalom habayit, lie. You're not getting anything. You're not making money. You're not going to be elected to office. But it means you'll have peace at home. The kid said, I flunked for the fourth time. Well, I flunked organic chemistry three times. So I flunked organic chemistry again. Oh, you stupid jerk. Why did you do that? You're never going to go to graduate school, blah, 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 blah. That's not shalom habayit. You know, maybe you should consider some other subjects. It's not for you. But I'm okay with you failing. I'm okay. It's Joe, Grandma, Aunt Tilly gives you two ties. You wear one. She gives you two ties for Christmas. And you wear one to some family event. And she looks at you and says, oh, how come you're not wearing the other tie? What was wrong? Wasn't it nice? Didn't you like it? And you can come up with something non-argumentative because you want to maintain peace. Yeah, you know, I had a really hard time. They were both excellent choices. The reality was the other one's halacious, and you wouldn't even want it at your own funeral. But rather than saying that, a sweater, the ugly Christmas stuff. So shalom habayit. But again, you're required in order to maintain peace and stability in relationships, but not if you're gaining something, not if you're doing it because you want some type of a favor from the other person. Doesn't apply, okay? Next is Pakua. Go ahead.
I was going to say, I would occasionally wear both ties at the same time, but
the event may not allow you to do that. The next is to save a life, which gets us around all those bad movies. Tell me where you hid this. Tell me what you did that, or I'll kill you, or I'll kill the dog, or I'm going to shoot the cat. It's okay to shoot the cat. You let them do that, but not the dog. You don't let it. It's really very simple. You tell them. Pikuach nefesh, even saving your own life. That's permitted, to save your own life. You make up, you lie, whatever it is a person wants from you. And that applies within other situations, other contexts. Okay, you're required. You're required to lie. And then there's some other situations, other times we can come up with where I would answer you, it's in everyone's best interest to lie. Just like I mentioned last time, the Mason-Dixon line, runaway slaves, slaves trying to get to freedom. You lie to protect their lives so that they can cross over, because a life is more important than this concept. And Judaism doesn't have white lies. These aren't white lies. You're just lying. And the best example is when Sarah gets pregnant. And God tells Abraham, your 90-year-old wife's pregnant. And he starts laughing. And then when God tells Sarah she's going to have a baby, she starts laughing. He says, what's wrong with you? My husband's 97 years old. And God says, you're not to say any of those things, because that would be hurtful. You're going to accept the event. And you, in terms of, are you happy? Sure you are. And is it okay? Sure you are. And can your husband have children? Evidently. So it's shalom habayit. What do I say? When do I do it? And we can keep using shalom habayit, requiring us in many settings.
Okay, since you mentioned television shows and bad jokes, so what happens when your wife asks you if you're dating your secretary?
Then you're going to have to tell the truth, because in that case, the lie is for your benefit. You want to get something out of it. You're hiding something, and there's a change in your status, and then that would not be permitted.
Okay. To me, it would be not getting killed, but... I would never.
Your wife was holding a 9mm and pointing it at you. And if you were then seriously, if there was a dramatic, immediate threat to your life, then we'd say pikuach nefesh. You would lie in that setting, and then you have to straighten out what's going on.
Okay. I'll remember that. Arm your wife before you tell her about your secretary.
That's correct. In which case you can defend yourself.
Well, thank you very much, Rabbi. That was very informative. Honey, where's the Glock? we'll look forward to talking to you next time.
And thank you for inviting me.